He is a senior editor with United World National Analytical Center, a former editor at large with ImperiaNews.com, a former editor in chief with Middle East Rising.com, and a senior geopolitical analyst with Press TV and CGTN American. He is a professor of international political economy. Welcome, Professor Alexander, to the One Sense channel.
Thank you for having me.
Yes. First of all, let us begin with the American election. Who's going to win the election, American election for 2020?
Well, that's a really difficult question, Ornella. If you look at the polls, Biden is ahead in some of the polls. Other polls indicate that they're neck to neck, very, very close. It's just as difficult to predict this election as it was in 2016. What would be a good indicator for us is next Tuesday, September 29th at 6 p.m. Pacific Standard Time and 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, we will have the first presidential debates. So we are going to monitor this very closely and look at the performance of Vice President Biden to see how he measures up with Donald Trump. A very interesting observation has been what the Speaker of the House of our Congress in the House of Representatives recommended to Joe Biden, which was to cancel all the debates because the Democrats believe, and this is a fact, that President Trump is an obnoxious liar. He just makes figures and numbers and figures as he goes along. And you can imagine debating with a lunatic like that and he's going to dominate the conversation. He has an astounding level of arrogance and continual expression of bellicose rhetoric towards various world leaders in an all-time low, even at Trump's standard. If he treats other world leaders like that, you can imagine how he would treat Vice President Biden. You have to understand that Donald Trump is a deranged, paranoid, conspiratorial, know-nothing president. He is not a rational man who operates within the norms of within the normal parameters that are set for a politician in this country. What we need in America are fact-based, rational conversations, not conversations led by conspiracy theorists, paranoid, borderline insane, or fully insane people that otherwise appear normal. So to answer your question, this is going to be a fair election between those who fear Trump versus those who fear Biden, both in terms of their policies, but also their personalities.
Yes, Alexander, as you know, here in Arab World, we try to shed a light on what happened inside America. But let me know from you exactly, can you describe for me the reality inside America between Trump and Biden? How's the competition on the state level?
The competition is difficult when you have a bully who breaks all the rules, and I'm talking about Trump, versus somebody who wants to be cordial, versus somebody like Biden who wants to be polite, wants to be civilized in a debate. It's very difficult for a competition to be measured with somebody like Trump who lowballs all the time. One of the aspects of Trump is his dictatorial tendencies. This repetitions that he's going to be in office for 8 more years. The fact that he wants to, he's saying that if he doesn't win, then somebody would cheat in the elections. Yesterday, we just passed a law that we are going to have a peaceful transition in power. This has been unprecedented in U.S. history, where a president refuses to leave office if he loses. And this is a typical Trump way of attacking his political opponents. He's addicted to vulgar mediocrity, a kind of malignant ignorance that his followers exhibit And all he has to do is show up and make up a bunch of lies and make people believe that those lies are real. And he has managed to convince around 20% of Americans who are his base that the other side is lying. He talks about fake news. He himself is the embodiment of fake news. If you remember, several years ago, he was in a racist way. He's a bigot and a racist. He was questioning whether President Obama was born in America versus Kenya, right? He's an absolute racist to the core. And so he made up that fake news that President Obama is not a real American. He was born overseas, and especially Kenya. He put that in attention because so people would have his followers, his racist followers, would be even more emboldened. So he is the generator of fake news. And this might be a little ridiculous to our viewers. After President Obama presented his birth certificate, he shut up. He said, okay, no problem, it's settled. But his followers, and this is the ridiculous part, Ornella, tried to question whether Michelle Obama is a man. This is absolutely crazy. He was saying that Michelle Obama is not a woman. Her name is Michael. And that President Obama is a homosexual, and he's his wife is a transsexual. This is the kind of lunacy that the American politics has been, the level has been lowered. He says everything crazy about other world leaders, whether it's Kim Jong-un, the Iranian leadership, anyone that opposes him, President Chavez down in Venezuela, anybody who stands up to him, he ridicules. Yes. So it's extremely difficult to compete with a person like that.
Okay, according to what are you telling us, as we know that today America faces a real problem, which is the discrimination. So can you describe for us actually how the challenge between Trump and Biden, according to this, all this, what you are trying to tell us?
Like I said earlier, it is difficult to compete with Trump if the other candidate doesn't go to that low level. You cannot be civilized with a person who's completely uncivilized. You cannot be a diplomat with a carnival barking clown. You know, he's a deranged authoritarian. He's a cutthroat thug. He's a malignant narcissist. He's a real estate mafia thug. He's, in my opinion, is a subhuman slime. A bona fide racist, a fascist with dictatorial tendencies, a liar and a deceiver, and a very dangerous rabble-rouser. How can you possibly compete at a civilized, diplomatic, solely political level, just focusing on ideas instead of personalities, with somebody like Trump? Trump's strategy is ad hominem. He will go after people. Instead of policies, he will go after people. And he will try to inject a lot of fear. He has tried to inject a lot of fear about the social unrest going in America, calling these people, anarchists, and they're going to come after you in the suburbs. He's trying to scare the suburbanite people, especially the women, that, that Antifa is a terrorist organization. I'm not saying they are or they are not a terrorist organization. Antifa is the organization on the left, stands for anti-fascist, right? And these people are duking it out in American streets, right? So he's trying to take the attention away from police brutality and say these people are terrorists, they're coming after you in the suburbs, get yourself a lot of guns to protect yourself because the police is not going to protect you. This is the level of lunacy that we are seeing in our politics today. It's unprecedented.
Okay, this is from the Trump's point of view, but what about Biden? How is the challenge between on the Biden side?
Biden is 77 years old. If he actually gets elected, he will be the oldest president in U.S. history. I hate to say this, Ornella, but the Democrats, the liberals, have become experts in nominating losers. 2016 election should have been an easy one. Hillary Clinton should have never been nominated. If Biden was the nominee of the Democratic Party in 2016, he would have defeated Trump. If Bernie Sanders was the nominee and Hillary Clinton stole that nomination away from Bernie Sanders. This is well documented in Michael Moore's documentary called Fahrenheit 11/9. Anyone who wants to know what happened in 2016 should watch that documentary. It's on Amazon Prime, and I believe it's on Netflix. Another documentary your viewers should watch is a documentary called Unfit. It's about how unfit President Trump is, and it's on Netflix. But going back to Vice President Biden, his excuse was his son died in 2015, 2016. He said he was overcome by grief. That's why he didn't run. This is not true. What has happened in our politics, whether it's the Republican Party or the Democratic Party, is we've turned into a system of monarchy. You know, you have to go through, like a certain person would be chosen to run and be nominated on the Democratic Party, like Hillary Clinton, and on the Republican Party, you know, a certain person like Jeb Bush had to be nominated because, you know, he's familiar with the Bush family. It's turned into a corrupt oligarchy. And the American people are sick and tired of it. That's why they chose a lunatic like Trump, because they believe you have to bring somebody outside of Washington, somebody who's not a politician, somebody who's a businessman. And to those people who think, you know, Trump came to drain the swamp. Remember that expression? He's there to drain the swamp. Trump himself is part of the swamp. This is the ridiculous lie that people bought. But going back to Biden, he's old. This is the impression people have, that he may have some cognitive abilities. This will come out in the debates, whether he forgets something. There's videos of him when he was giving interviews. He fell asleep. We'll talk about Biden. So there were so many other people who could have challenged Trump within the Democratic Party. But our politics are so corrupt that they actually pick somebody 4 years, 3 years beforehand. Then we go through this idiotic process that looks democratic, but it's not. The nominee is picked a long, long time ago. Certainly by the fact that he has chosen Kamala Harris, a very well-qualified person, a prosecutor, an attorney general, former attorney general in my home state of California. If something happens to President Biden, hopefully, President Biden, then Kamala Harris is very qualified. And in my opinion, she should become the first female president in the United States. It's about time that we get rid of these old white men and bring women into politics at the highest echelon of power. And it's shameful in a country that calls itself a democracy, a country that calls itself, you know, equal for genders, men and women, that we haven't had a female president. And when we try to nominate somebody like Hillary Clinton, you couldn't have chosen the worst person to represent women, because she was so masculine and so hypocritical and so phony and so part of the mainstream that people got sick and tired of it. It's about time that the Democratic Party or the Republican Party choose a woman as their primary nominee, so we would have a female president. We got to get rid of some of these old white men that are destroying the American politics. First and foremost, President Trump.
Okay, what can you the size of the vote between the two candidates?
Can you repeat your question? I lost you for a second.
Yeah, sure. What can you tell us about the size of the vote between the two candidates?
The size of what?
Of the vote.
Yes, the size of the vote, yeah. As you know, we don't have a popular democracy in this country. We have a very strange and complicated delegatorial system. In 2016, if we actually had a popular democracy, which means one vote counts for one person, instead of the Electoral College, which is an antiquated, even racist system when it was designed 240 years ago, then Hillary Clinton won by 3 million votes. So what it has come down to answer your question, is it usually comes down to 4 or 5 states. This is ridiculous. California is solidly in the hand of Democrats. Texas is solidly in the hand of Republicans. New York is solidly in the hand of Democrats. So certain states, even like, I'm a conservative Republican, believe it or not. I'm one of the biggest critics of Trump, but I'm a conservative Republican. In California, my vote doesn't have any meaning at the federal level. It will have a meaning within the state of California, because whoever gets the majority of the votes in California gets the delegatorial votes, right? And so 270 is the number of whoever gets closer to 270, they're going to win. This system has got to go. We need to have a constitutional convention, which is not going to happen because the atmosphere in America is so toxic. We need to have a constitutional convention to get rid of electoral college system. So the election wouldn't matter on like four or five minor states. This year, the election will be focused on Wisconsin, Ohio, Pennsylvania, Indiana. Usually when it comes down to that, it comes down to these very minor states instead of powerful states that have a lot of people in their population. In 2000, the vote came down to the state of Florida. This is ludicrous, absolutely ludicrous. And George Bush stole the election. So it is hard to predict who's going to win unless you look at the numbers within those four or five states. Wisconsin is very important because we had the social unrest and the police brutality take place in the biggest city in Wisconsin, which is Milwaukee. In Milwaukee, there's this very tense atmosphere. And Missouri is another state. So, you know, it's laughable, the system we have here, because it's not democratic. It's based on that, you know, electoral college system, and electoral college system is not democratic at all.
Okay, if Trump failed in that election, what might be his reflection?
Well, he has said that if he loses the election, it means that somebody cheated. This is unprecedented. He doesn't want to leave office. He is really acting like Mussolini. He even looks like Mussolini, the dictator, the El Duce of Italy. He's acting in a very bizarre, strange manner. The problem we have, Ornella, in America is what I call political tribalism. Over the last 15 to 20 years, we've seen an increase in what people call tribalism. Some people call tribalism, the sociologists. Basically, yeah, you can sum it up as contempt for other people's view and say, I disagree with you. And by the way, you're wrong on everything. So there's no democracy can survive this sort of tribalist political system. It just won't work. And Trump knows that. He's capitalizing on that. And he says he's not going to leave. He says they need to make changes that he would even stay after 4 years for a third term. Now, is he saying this because he's a clown and he likes to rabble rouse, or does he really believe it? You can imagine if there's some kind of a crisis, a terrorist attack, or COVID gets a whole lot worse, that some crazy thing like this, some possibility like this could happen. We don't know, but what we do know is a couple of days ago, US Congress passed the law and said there will be peaceful transition of power. That's the end of it. The end of the conversation. That doesn't, he cannot say, oh, I lost because there was there was cheating. And the thing that your audience needs to know is that, you know, he's using the postal system because we are going to cast our ballots through mail because of COVID. There is an organized sabotaging effort of our postal system when it comes to mailing ballots in order to cast doubt on the system and cheat and steal the election. And it's very interesting. The person that President Trump put in charge of the postal office, they're getting rid of actual post mailboxes, the blue mailboxes we have all around in the streets. They're getting rid of this. It's called voter suppression. And they're doing this in a lot of areas where there's minorities like blacks and Latinos, which traditionally vote Democratic. This is absolutely mind-boggling. He's casting doubt on the very election themselves. He's destroying what is left of American democracy.
Okay, but Alexander, let me first understand from you what might be the program, political, economical program of the two candidates, Trump or Biden, until now.
This is a very interesting question. It comes down to two things. Are we going to continue the neoliberal globalist agenda? Or are we going to, are we going to go back to the national sovereignty model? Mm-hmm. There is a movement in the world. Brexit was a perfect example that one of the most important countries in Europe wanted to go to the national sovereignty model. They call themselves nationalists today. In America, the new, the racist, this white supremacist, they call themselves economic nationalists. This is a loaded term. So are we going to continue this neoliberal globalist agenda? And the country that's benefiting the most from it is communist China. They're stealing everybody's job. The Belt and Road Initiative from Beijing to Beirut. Are we going to continue this system, or are we going to go to Trump's and Putin's and Bolsonaro down in Brazil? Are we going to go to that model? Because a lot of countries, the new liberal globalist model has failed in many, many countries as jobs have been exported to China, millions of jobs. They are not coming back. And that's one of the reasons Trump got in, because he was talking about China. What we have in this country right now is a trade war with China. It's an economic war with China. And COVID-19 has been a conspiracy between the United States and China. I'm not saying it's real. It's very real. It's not some crazy thing that they're exaggerating, but it's turned into biological warfare between China and United States. And I think President Trump is correct when he calls it the Chinese virus. I think he's absolutely right on that. So are we going to go back to this one world order, which in the future may bring out one world currency? This is very dangerous stuff. It's very Orwellian. Are we going to go to that level? And this is facilitated by technology very dangerously, very, very dangerously. Are we going to go back to each nation being in charge of its own destiny, try to be independent, try to make sure jobs are not exported to China? This is at the very ideological, international, political, and geopolitical center. This election is at that. But unfortunately, the person that's representing the national sovereignty is an absolute moron like President Trump. We had many other people that believe in the libertarian. One second. That believe in the this is the libertarian thesis, what I'm telling you. The national sovereignty model. We had people like Rand Paul, the senator from Kentucky, who, by the way, ran for president in 2016. We have serious people that are talking about this. What do we get? We get Trump, who hijacked this discussion and took it to the crazy level that it is in right now.
According to the New World Order, I noted that with the virus, previous virus, we didn't use or adopt the protocol of using the mask. Why today with the corona pandemic we use the mask? We use this protocol.
Which mask? Can you repeat the last mask? Did you say or map?
The mask on the face because of corona.
Oh, the mask. The mask. Well, yeah. This is another conspiracy theory that Trump is trying to push, or his crazy followers, his base. They're intentionally not wearing the mask because they think that's the macho thing to do. It's manly. The whole thing is a lie. In the beginning of this pandemic, when Trump wasn't serious about, you know, promoting people wearing the mask, the numbers went up. Today, the numbers are over 200,000 people dead in the United States. Around 1,000 people are dying every day. Most of them are people with pre-existing medical condition and the elderly. We don't know about COVID-19. We are learning as we're going along. What we do know is that in societies that kept social distance and wore the mask, the numbers have not been as high as places like Brazil and United States, where the leader is a crazy person. So it's a very dangerous respiratory illness. The mask only works if both people wear it. When you wear the mask, you're actually protecting the other person. If you're wearing the mask and protecting the other person is not doing the same thing. They're jeopardizing your health. So in the United States, we have to come up with some kind of a middle ground between public health and constitutional rights. We are a very rebellious, individualistic society. Everybody's talking about constitutional rights, especially Trump supporters. Well, if your constitutional right is violating my health, then your constitutional right is secondary to public health. And personally, I believe in wearing the mask because we don't know enough. about this virus not to wear the mask, when we took away the regulations, when people started to go out more and behaving like there was no COVID-19, the numbers went up drastically. And the numbers are going to go up drastically because the fall is coming, you have the flu season. So there is so much misinformation, Ornella, so much lies and paranoid, crazy conspiracy theories out there that are muddying the water. What we have in America is a mental health crisis by crazy people that are functioning, somewhat talking, but they're paranoid. They're paranoid and they're mentally ill.
Tell us, this mental health care that Trump failed to get over his promise when he win the first election. So we see now America face a big problem with the health care. What can you say about this in one word?
The problem with what?
Healthcare.
Yeah. He's been very counterproductive. He's trying to take away Obamacare. There are around 40 million people in America who rely on Obamacare, better known as the Affordable Healthcare Act. And he wants to take that away. He wants to go back to the old days, which was an absolute disaster. If you had a pre-existing condition, you couldn't even get insurance. If your insurance benefits ran out, you would be without insurance. You could have cancer. If your benefit ran out, you would be without insurance. The number one reason for bankruptcy in the United States are out of control healthcare costs. This has become something in the past, it was usually not an exciting topic. People were focusing on international affairs, this, that, economy. They were not focusing enough on healthcare, but now this has become a very critical issue. And during Obama's time, you had to buy insurance. You had to do it. Trump went ahead and took that away. So you won't be jeopardized if you don't buy insurance. Some people think that's a good thing. If your health is in good condition, why should you have to buy health insurance? Again, the problem is in the individual versus collectivism. If you don't have a health insurance and you go to a hospital and they end up giving you free healthcare because you're poor, it's going to raise the insurance cost for everybody. And Trump wants to go back in time. And what is very dangerous, Ornella, is that in the Supreme Court, if he actually nominates somebody before he wins or loses, we're going to have a 6-3 majority of the conservatives. And the conservatives want to completely get out of Obamacare. So we're going to go back to the old times where millions of Americans couldn't afford to have health care and they had to rely on public health care system, which was already maximized to the capacity because a lot of people that shouldn't get that, a lot of undocumented immigrants are taking advantage of that. And Americans who've been paying taxes their whole life, the system is simply not there for them. So we will see that for sure during the debates when it comes to healthcare between Biden and Trump.
Okay. As you know, everybody is waiting the American election. So you know that we are waiting how might be the agreement, Iranian agreement about the nuclear. What might be the challenges in the Middle East in the next step after this election? With Biden or with Trump, with Iranian nuclear agreement, or with the peace agreement, Abraham agreement, or in Lebanon and Hezbollah and the French initiative. Mm-hmm. What can you say about all these issues?
There's many questions. I'll go ahead and answer it. I know. The Iranian nation has not only resisted Trump's maximum pressure, but it has also flourished and advanced while pursuing its historic and civilizational role as a pivot of peace and stability in the Middle East. That's what the Iranians think. This is what I just told you is what President Rouhani said at the United Nations General Assembly. Iran is a big part of this puzzle, the geopolitical puzzle. Iran is China's secret weapon in killing off the U.S. dollar's global reserve status. But this is a long-term project, not a short-term one. And now you see how Iran has brought China into the Middle East. They signed a 25-year-old agreement with China and a 20-year-old agreement with Russia. These countries are going to be present in the Persian Gulf and in the Sea of Oman. This changes the geopolitics of the region. It's sort of like a dam against Israel and United States. Now, as far as the Abraham Accord, that calling this the Abraham Accord is a blasphemy, in my opinion. To put the name of Abraham, Father Abraham, who was the father of Muslims and Jews, father of Ismail, and also the father of Isaac. So to call it that and to disrespect 200 million Arabs and 1.5 billion Muslims, non-Arab Muslims, is an absolute blasphemy. You bring in corrupt countries like the UAE and Bahrain. Most of your viewers don't know Bahrain used to be part of Iran until the early 1970s. Iran gave it away. That was part of the agreement to kick out the British out of the Persian Gulf. The British said, you know what, we will leave the Persian Gulf, but you have to make Bahrain an independent country. That was one of the most horrible decisions that the Shah of Iran made in the 1970s because he was the stooge to Washington. So there is a fatigue with Iran in the region, in my opinion. Yes, the Syrians won the war at a very expensive price. The country is decimated. And Washington and her allies, her regional and extra-regional allies, because they lost, especially, you know, NATO I'm talking about, because they lost in Syria, they're trying to export the chaos over there to Lebanon. Everybody knows that after the Ottomans fell, after they lost World War I, Middle East was divided between Britain and France. And Lebanon and Syria were assigned to France. So we have this little man, Emmanuel Macron, coming in right after the big explosion in Beirut, which was extremely disrespectful. The head of a former colonial, a cruel colonial power coming to a country that was just devastated by a strange explosion, coming in, and the Lebanese people are so desperate because the governmental system has failed. It's turning into a failed state. This man coming in and taking advantage of people's sense of victimhood, coming in and trying to attract the global attention to him. But we don't know. We have very strange talks between Hezbollah and France. Could this be some kind of a peace talk that France is mediating? We do know that the Iranian budget, because of these horrific maximum pressure campaign of Washington against Iran, that Iran is bankrupt. Iran's currency went from 3,000 toman to over 28,000 toman. 9 times it has lost its value, 9 times, 900% during the past 7 years of this liberal President Rouhani. So the Iranians are bankrupt. They can no longer support their proxies in Lebanon. They cannot adequately support their proxies in Syria and in Iraq. And they're having a very hard time supporting the proxies in Yemen. So is it possible that Hezbollah is trying to lobby the European Union through France to be taken out of the terrorist list? Because as you know, and I wrote an article about this, yeah, Hezbollah was assigned as a foreign terrorist organization by the European Union. Something like that. I'm not sure if it was an FTO, but you know, their political as well as the military branch was assigned as a terrorist organization. Could it be that they're trying to lobby the European Union to be taken out of the sanction list so they can collect money from other countries? That may be a possibility. We don't know. We are speculating. What we do know is that the Iranian budget, especially the IRGC, the Iranian Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps, and IRGC QF, Quds Force, their budget has drastically been decreased because Tehran is bankrupt. So there's all sorts of things that are going on right now. As far as these Arab countries like UAE and Bahrain wanting to become allies with Israel, this is the same kind of mentality that brought Iran and Iraq into war in 1980. They're trying to scare all these Arab countries from, you know, they're using Iran to scare the Arab countries. The Iranians have their own agenda. They want to become a huge empire again. Everybody knows that. So a lot of Arab countries feel threatened by Iran, and some of them, unfortunately, are misguided, and the Israelis are coming in and filling that vacuum of fear. But the sentiment in the Arab street is quite different, very, very different. We got the Arab leadership, who are the lackeys and the puppets of Europeans and Americans, and then we have the Arab street, which is very awake and alert. But the Arab street is suffering in many of these countries. Even in Saudi Arabia, they're economically suffering because of economic mismanagement. So in a way, they're desperate. And when you're desperate, you become less ideological. When your belly is full, you can afford to be ideological. You can afford to have a resistance. But when you're dying, when your children are dying either from famine or war, you become very pragmatic. And if anybody who's been hungry, they know what I mean.
Okay, Alexander, in a brief message, what can you say about the Abraham Agreement is different from Oslo and Camp David, or it might be a critical response?
It is different from both Oslo and especially the Camp David. You have to understand, when Camp David was signed, Iran was not an enemy of Israel. Iran was actually had a friendly relationship with Israel. The so-called Abraham Agreement is mostly to ostracize and isolate Iran. And that's where Iran has a pivotal role. It is a very reactionary agreement against Iran. It is an agreement to deceive Arab countries into thinking Iran is the enemy. In the 1977 Camp David Agreement, Arab countries themselves were considered Israel's enemy because, I mean, look at Egypt. Egypt and Syria were almost one country, United Arab Republic. They were going to bring Yemen into it too. Three countries that don't share any borders standing up to Israel. That went away. You have a country like Jordan, which has normal relations with Israel. Of course, Egypt as well. So this is a very anti-Iran agreement. The Camp David Accord was not an anti-Iran agreement. It was an anti-war, anti-Arab coalition agreement. And of course, Egypt sold out, and President Sadat paid with his life. So, and also Oslo Agreement was the agreement between Palestinians and Israelis. In this situation, these Arab countries like UAE and Bahrain, they're sidelining the Palestinians altogether. They're completely betraying the Palestinians. You know, the Oslo Agreement was not about betraying Palestinians. It was an accord that President Clinton played a central role. It was supposedly was going to bring Fatah and Israel together and sidelining the folks in Gaza. So it is completely different. In my opinion, the so-called Abraham Agreement is just another horrible agreement to betray the poor Palestinian people.
Yes. Alexander Azatkan, thank you for this interview.
My pleasure.
Thank you.